Welcome to the Nevada State Museum. Great night for us to celebrate Black History Month. My name is Bob Nina. I'm a curator of history, and we're very fortunate that Bertha Mullins is here tonight to do the program. But first, before I introduce Bertha, I want to thank Mary Covington. I think Bertha would include you in the name of that. Members who really put this all together, working with Bertha. As I said, good evening. Welcome to the Francis Humphrey Lecture Series. We've been doing this now for 24 years. We're very proud of that. I'm not sure Francis Humphrey, who was a longtime teacher, just passed. And Reno High, we also would love to be here tonight with you. Bertha Mullins is a longtime Reno resident, known throughout Nevada for her commitment and dedication to increasing the quality of life for families. Her public service on boards and community service organizations and her work in political, economic, and professional arenas. Bertha has served on over 32 boards, including the Sierra Nevada Girl Scouts, Truckee Meadows Habitat for Humanities, the Reno Sparks NAACP Executive Board, the Northern Nevada Black Cultural Awareness Society, and has received many awards from Governors Callahan, List, Bryan, Miller, and Senators Laxalt, Cannon, Ensign, and Reed. Bertha holds a BS in Health and Human Science from the University of Nevada, Reno, was employed by the Economic Opportunity Board from 1969 to 1981, and currently serves as the Vice President of Community Outreach for Wells Fargo Bank. So at this time, I'd like to turn the program over to Bertha.
Oh, thank you, Mark. Thank you. Thank you, Bob, for that nice introduction. I just like to say that I am just so glad to be here. You know, I love people, so it's not hard for me to talk. Yeah. And especially to be able to talk about something that you're very passionate about. And so we're going to move right on into the program, and then I'll come back. But I want to introduce you to a young lady that I've known most of all of her life. And looking at her, you would not believe that she's retired from Washoe County court system, and she was a court clerk for the Honorable Judge Elliott, and she's known for her singing throughout. And in our culture, we come up in the church and they start you in a Bible class, and you learn to sing, and there's your special soloists and choirs, and as a youth you admire them, and before long they have you singing in a junior choir or adult choir, and God's willing, a senior choir. That's where. And so I'd like to introduce Carlos Lloyd. Would you come, please? Let's give her a hand.
Thank you.
Wasn't that beautiful?
Yes.
Carlos is going to come back at the end of the program and do another number. Tonight, I want to talk about some people, and I might mention their names again. Some of them are not quite here, but I want to talk about the members of the Northern Nevada Dr. Martin Luther King, we recall, Advisory Committee. And I'm just so honored to have some of them in our audience tonight. And they're going to be around maybe for later. You can ask them questions and they'll get all nervous and everything, but they'd love to talk to you too about it. This committee was established in the early 1983, and lots of people, we were the work in the trenches, helping to make the holiday become a state holiday in which most of us enjoy. And I'm going to ask the ones that are here, and you'll see some of them that I have pictures on the screen. But one, I'm just gonna start, and he's not shy. He might act like he is, but he's not shy. And that's none other than Reverend W.C. Webb. And we're asking you to stand, Reverend Webb, so people can see who you are. He's a longtime member of our community and certainly a strong leader in the faith base. The other person who is here tonight and served as a longtime member of the committee, but she's also known for her volunteerism in our community for years and years. And that's none other than Lucille Aiden. Would you stand here? And the other person we're looking for, he said he would be here, but you know how life is, it doesn't always go the way you want. I know for me it doesn't. And so something might have came up, and his name is Reverend Glenn Taylor. He's the pastor of, what's Glenn's church?
Greater
Light. Thank you. So he might still come in. Another member of our community committee, and you'll see the list of names, is Jerry Holloway. Jerry had to fill in on a board. He had to be the quorum maker tonight. So he wasn't able to make it, but he is still in our community. Just as we go into the presentation, this is also what's known to us as Black History Month. And this is also a passion of mine because America never did get my story right. And so lots of the history as a senior, I'm still learning about my culture. It was not taught in the history books, and so much of it is still left out. So I'm just gonna interject a little bit, and I'm gonna do that with talking about the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. As we move forward in the presentation today, I wanna talk about Francis Humphrey. Francis Humphrey, I knew. I'm a graduate of Reno High. Doesn't look like it, huh?
No.
I kinda grew up. And my brother, Luther Mack, is also a graduate of Reno High. And he needed a counselor. And so Francis Humphrey was his counselor. I think Luther still needs one. But it was such an honor to know her, such a sweet lady. So as we move forward and talking about this Northern Nevada Dr. Martin Luther King Holiday Advisory Committee. And when I started out, I was the project director. I was responsible for programs behind the scene. And I actually started the third Sunday before Dr. King's holiday, putting programs together. The main purpose of the committee was to raise the awareness of who Dr. King was. And I'm finding even today, it's so many people don't know who Dr. King was and don't know in reference to what sacrifice he made that we would someday be free. And one of the pastors in our community that I reached out to have these interfaith services was Reverend Webb. I went to Reverend Webb and asked him, I wanted to have this interfaith services just the Sunday before the holiday and on a 3 o'clock. And the reason I chose 3 o'clock, because most of us are in church. Some of us a little there longer than others. Some people get out early on Sundays, but there are some that might get out at late. So I chose 3 o'clock because that was the most convenient time for our community. I could tell you a lot about this man, and I'm glad that he is here today. He has done so much in our community for seniors, youth, planning, development, anything that he and his wife could do in our community, the volunteerism that they do. He is retired now. I don't know if you ever retire from ministry, because there's always room and there's always a need. And I'm so delighted to have you, Reverend Webb, and I want to thank you personally for all the help that you did in opening your doors to your church, Second Baptist. Would you help me give him another hand? Now, the other minister who is not here, years ago, Glenn Taylor used to be the pastor. Can anybody remember when Glenn was a pastor of Greater New Hope Missionary Baptist Church? And this is the other church that opened their doors to have the services for all the community interfaith to come and have. So I wanted to recognize him, and maybe we'll get an opportunity to do it another time. And as we move forward in our program, this is Reverend Johnny Collins. We lost Johnny in 2000, but he was a pastor of New Jerusalem Baptist Church. And he, along with Jerry Holloway and myself, were the first members appointed by Governor Richard Bryan to be the Dr. Martin Luther King commissioners. Governor Bryan appointed commissioners from Northern Nevada and also from Southern Nevada. In addition to Reverend Collins, he was sort of like the leader, the forefront in Northern Nevada. He also had a career in education. He was a middle school teacher, and he was so popular. He had such a personality, and the kids loved him. But he was also part of the group and very important part. And we miss Johnny. As we think about the making of this group, the committee, I want you to, this is part of Second Baptist Choir. I'm sorry they're not here to sing for you tonight. Because we would hear really some good singing. And one of the reasons I had to put the choir in, because you can't talk about Dr. King without talking about faith and talking about church. His father, as you know, was a pastor of the Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta. And he came up in a church And his mother, all the family was very important to the church. One of the reasons that the church is so much a part of Black history, because that's their source of strength. Doing the Jim Crow laws and not being accepted and the discrimination and racism, all those negative words that you can think of. Church was a place that you could go and find a little peace. And church was also a place to go if there was danger in your community, and there always was, because you were never seen as equal in your community. And it's so much even like today. So I had to put the choir in there. For some of you that are familiar, in my day we used to have a quartet. Do you guys remember quartets in the church?
Yeah.
Do you remember those pats? And, you know, some of the best singing you ever wanted to hear was in. So as we think about Dr. King and what his contribution was to America, this is still, that was his dream. But I believe that many of us sitting in this room, that's our personal dream too. That dream has not been fulfilled. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. This is 2017, and what I see going on in our country today and the harsh words that I hear, I wonder, what does it take for us to wake up? Martin gave the greatest gift that he could give, and that was his life. He died at the age of 39, but his dream was always seeing people as people and not by the color of their skin. We're not there yet. I have a dream that this is my little, well, I have a dream that one day little black boys and girls will be holding hands with little white boys and girls. He said this in 1993. I think we're all looking for this, and this is in a march that he was in. And I tell you, it doesn't take a whole lot of people to move a nation. You can do great things with just a small group. If you're determined and you want to make a sacrifice, and even though you make the sacrifice, other people will take the credit, but you know who did the work. And when you're wanting to make a change, and we all should be standing to that plan now, is making a change in direction that our country is going. We need to make that change. And these are the members that I've named on the local Northern Nevada group who took time out of their schedule to plan, and they wanted to make a change in Northern Nevada. And they also wanted to make a change to make sure that Dr. King's birthday became a state holiday. And when Governor Bryan got in office, he wasted no time in seeing that the bill came about. In 1983, he made an announcement at a large Black history program that he wanted to make Dr. King's birthday a state holiday. So Bill 99 was introduced. And then in 1983, there was throughout the nation people signing petitions for President Ronald Reagan. They wanted it to Martin's birthday to become a federal holiday. So the Congress got petitioned from all over the world. In 1983, President Reagan executed an executive order making Dr. King's birthday a federal holiday. And the federal holiday wasn't recognized until 1986. Lots of people didn't want that to happen. They said that he had never served in an office. He was never a mayor. He was never a governor. He was never in the legislature. But he had a heart for people, and he didn't take a quiet seat. And that was the first bill was introduced, and then they made a decision to postpone it indefinitely. And then in September 1985, Governor Richard Bryan, he made an executive order honoring Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday and establishing it a state holiday. And so he honored the holiday before it became a state holiday. It wasn't a state holiday until 1987. And that's when we honored it. As we go forward with the, there we go, thank you. So in 1986 to May 87, the committee started, you know, in 1983. Keeping before the community about who Dr. King was, with passion in different areas all over the community. That was their goal. And we had people in the legislature. They hadn't heard of Martin. And some of them were from the rural Nevada. And we didn't hold that against him. Our goal was to educate. Because in our society, we don't live on the same side of the track. We don't interface. We don't see you in church. That's where lots of us go on Sunday morning. We're doing better. Some go to churches through the week. But it is the mission. The more that you know and the more that you see me, you find that I have red blood. Did you know that? And I believe if I needed a transfusion, they would give me red blood. They would not look at the color of my skin, but they would look at how they could save my life. I think when you start explaining that in your home and around your dinner tables or your breakfast tables or footballs or sports, and you start encouraging your children to be multicultural and different things, they come to find out we're more together than we are apart. This is a proclamation that we received, our committee, in making Dr. Martin Luther King's Jr. birthday and a state holiday. Some of the guest speakers that we had to come and to speak, we had at that time, the president of Morehouse College, and we just, people just read about Morehouse as such a distinguished school, but to have somebody actually to come from Atlanta and be in Little Reno was quite an honor. I wanted to talk about Senator Bill Raggio, what a key part he played in the background. He was in the Senate, but it takes everybody to move the political ball, as you would say. And if I couldn't get to him, I knew somebody who could. And somebody that knew him very well. And this is Luther Matt. So he was able to talk to Senator Raggio. I knew him too, but I gave it to Luther to let him, you know, let him do it. And say, it's amazing. You never know the influence that you have with people. And for those that are political, they might not listen to the neighbor across the street, but they might listen to the neighbor on the other side of the street. You never know who's having tea or coffee or playing golf. I don't play golf. With someone, and they could explain it to them. and let them know what the political issue is. And we know that there's people in our society, they've been doing that a long time. We know the decisions are not made in the chambers. They're made other places before they get to the chamber. So when you find out where the politics is and who's in charge and who can persuade others, you're in the game as far as the politics. And some of us are still learning that game. So I wanted to thank Luther Mack. I think he's in Las Vegas. He could not be here tonight. But it takes all of us to make the world, to make the neighborhood, to make our communities. I don't know about you, but I just like to interject. I'm older now, but my mother always cared about the kids next door, across the street. That's the kind of community we came up in. And they looked out for one another. And I believe that's what we need in our neighborhoods and communities, and we certainly do need it in the White House. I wanted to speak a little bit, I wanted to speak a little bit about Senator Maurice Washington. He was in the Senate at the time AB 116 made it that far. And he was pushing from that end. And we knew him, so we had an opportunity to give him the support that he needed in the Senate at that time. This is a picture of Senator Bryan and the lady next to him. Some of you might not know. But this was after a march. I had organized a march in Reno and marched from Virginia Street. And I believe we have where's Marsha? Marsha, did you have your kids with you then?
I had one in the stroller and my older was right next to on my side.
Oh, thank you for marching. Thank you for marching. So we organized this march from Virginia Street to the University of Nevada. And I had invited Governor Richard Bryan then to be our guest speaker. But you know, as I was thinking about this presentation, I wanted to thank everybody, and I might not have that opportunity. There might be some of you in our audience that was pushing for AB 116 to pass. It might have been that you read about the bill. You might have knew somebody in the legislature. So I want to give you a hand for helping in the silent way. Senator Joe Neal, many of you know Senator Joe Neal. And he was in the Senate, but he was also one of the pushers of this bill. He's retired now, but he certainly was a force in Southern Nevada. And we thank him for his contribution. Assemblyman Wendell Williams. Wendell was in the legislature. He was appointed by Governor Richard Bryan to be a commissioner. And he fought the fight in the chambers, and he fought the fight in Las Vegas. Governor Bryan appointed several members as commissioners in Las Vegas. And we're always working to help to have Dr. King's birthday become a state holiday. And so all of the people, some of the people you saw in the forefront and you didn't see in the back, but our goal was the same. And I think that when I look at my country today, it breaks my heart. And how we speak of color, how we speak of racism, how we speak of segregation. Now, I don't know many of you know anything about the Jim Crow laws. See, environment makes a difference. See, we remove a lot from the South, but I know what it is to be discriminated against. I live with this skin every day, and there's no welcome mat for me. So, I live with the color of my skin, And then sometimes I'm segregated because of my gender. I just happen to be a woman, and I'm glad about it. I don't have any problems. So I know what it is to be discriminated in that area. And then I am a faith-based person. So I know what it is to be segregated against because of your religious belief. And so it's important for us to never forget and to recognize racism anywhere. But not only to recognize it, it's your responsibility to say something about it. You can't be silent. You can't be silent. For those that are doing what they feel is right, and we know that it's wrong, they're not silent in speaking out against injustice. We must also take the torch and in our communities, in our neighborhoods, to speak against that. Well, that was a little political side note, Bertha. I said, yes, it was. I wanted to, I wanted you to know that the whole reason there's a group of people that feels passionate about people just being people, and that's our youth. They learn by example. You're not born to hate people. You're taught love, or you're taught hate. So I think when we think about our children, let's be watchful of how we act. Let's be watchful of our words. Kids hear what you say. And you might want to take the words back, but it's too late. So I think that I think about that all the time. We have people growing up, youth that are growing up today, they don't know what love is, compassion. It's our responsibility to show them. Don't you think there's been enough talk and no action? So I think it starts early where you have a brother or sister, and these are words of Dr. King's. I have decided to stick to love. Hate is too great a burden to bear. Dr. King. We might remember that Dr. King entered Morehouse College at the age of 15. And he went on to become an ordained minister within the Baptist Church. And then he led the boycott at the age of 26. What were you doing at the age of 26? I want to ask you how old you are now, how old you are now, and what you're doing for justice, for human rights, for civil rights. It's never too late to have a part. This is my great-granddaughter. It says, love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Do you find that statement true? Sometimes people, you just want to hate them, but you can't. But when you get to know them, you get to talk to them, you have lunch with them, you can't hate them anymore. You find out that you have more in common. I had these t-shirts made, I think in 1987. I just thought, I had one little one. And I thought it'd be interesting to reflect on 1987, and this is 2016. Living the dream, let freedom ring. The time is always right to do the right thing. I wanted to to illustrate and to reason for those that are not there with your love and compassion for other races. I wanted you to reach out of your comfort zone, you know, and look and to see how you might get to know them. And you be the first one to offer a hand in that area. I want to know, had anybody ever heard of the Northern Nevada Dr. Martin Luther King Holiday Advisory Committee before tonight? You had heard from it. And you had heard about it. But I think it's important you don't always know the people who are working behind the scene. And I don't know who suggested to the Nevada Museum that they contact me as a presenter for the Francis Humphrey series, but I'm glad they did. And I'm honored to be here to talk about not only Dr. King, but I was able to work with people who actually work to make the bill become a state holiday. I got to be very close to Governor Bryan. I even went to D.C. when he became a senator. He would give me a call when he was in town and say, Bertha, I'm going to be in town, and where you want me to go to church today? He wanted to be in the African-American community, and he knew if he was there on a Sunday, because I told him that I go to church on Sunday mornings. And that's just in my culture. My parents brought me up that way. And I don't know, I'm sure you've heard this song. It says, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. So in one of the ways to let your light shine is loving your neighbor. Doesn't matter who they are. Doesn't matter what part of town they live, what school they go to. We feel that other people have separated us, but on Sunday morning, you'll find us in a place of worship. So Senator Bryan would call me, and I took him to most of all the African American churches. I would call the pastors. Bonnie came along with him, and we got to know each other really good. I want to let you know, you can't be silent, and you can't be non-political. Pretty quiet in here, Bertha. It's either yes or no. The best way to know your candidate is when they're running for office.
Yeah.
I mean, really get to know them. And then after they get in, it's your responsibility to keep up and see what they're doing. And if they're not doing what you think, you develop a force and say, we're here to talk about this. So many times we put them in and that's it. But I'm encouraging you today. I think you ought to be stirred. I'm glad to see these marches. I'm glad because too many people gave their blood. Too many people died, did not get chance to see their adulthood, did not get chance to see their grandkids. They died that we might be free. Let freedom ring from every mountaintop. Well, I've been in the church and I can use the pulpit, as they would say. It's important to tell the message. You cannot forget. And certainly as an African American, I know from whence I came. I know people in my family endured hardships that were denied jobs, not because they couldn't do the job. They were denied jobs and employment, as we would say, because of the color of their skin. They wanted the same thing as any other man and a woman would want. That is a quality of life for their families. There's no difference there. Let freedom ring. At this time, we're going to have Carlos. Are there any questions? I went through the slides and, yes.
I do have a question. Thank you, that was great. So how do we fight back, the Attorney General of the United States is somebody that has kind of a bad past. How do we fight back? I mean, we can't even get our senators to have a town hall.
I think, I think you just have to put the pressure on your senators who represents you. And then if you directly. And I think that the other thing that we all know that Dr. King expressed was nonviolence. Persistence, nonviolence. And I think it might be tougher in a way, but I know that we're creative and we can do it. Thank you for that question. Yes, Mary?
You spoke a little bit about some of the people who were resistant to the idea of having it be a holiday, that, you know, he was never a senator, he never. When you were encountering negativity and people who didn't want to have that happen, how much of that did you encounter and how did you deal with it?
I think lots of, and it was, there were, as I recall through, about four assembly people did not vote to make Dr. King's a holiday. And one of the main opposition that kept coming up had to do with money. It had to do, this came up a lot within the rural areas, how they were going to pay for it, what it was going to cost, what would the budget be for the city and the governmental agency. But I just think the least, I think, you know, when you really want something and having lived with racism and prejudice in Nevada, not in Mississippi or Georgia, but in Nevada, you have to have a tough skin and be persistent. And that was one of the main things. But I think that we owe so much to education, you got to keep telling the story. We're not there yet. Lots of sacrifices have been made, but our country is not there, and that is equality for everyone.
Can I say one thing? You may be thinking that I've lived in Austin, Nevada quite a bit of my time, and I played the organ at the Episcopal Church there, the pipe organ. Anyway, a group of four or five people, colored people, came in one day and they said, we didn't know what to do with the service or anything. And they said, well, can you be a choir and sing something? And so I played a hymn called Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
Oh.
And we wanted to sing the whole thing and we thought it was great. They were really nice people.
Yes.
They came from Reno originally.
Yes. That's great. Anybody ever been to Austin? Ah! That's great. That's great.
I have a question. In politics, at least based upon my life's experience, sometimes there are tremendous conversions of people who, when you start out and you're working towards something such as to recognize Dr. Martin Luther King, there are some people who maybe as a gut reaction are opposed to it, but they come up with excuses. I used to work in government, so I understand, oh no, it's going to cost too much money
yes.
for people not to work that day. They're going to have a holiday. Well, we know what that could be like. But were there any people that you experienced that you really saw a real conversion where they, once you and your friends and folks worked with them, where they really did a 180, where they really turned around? Like, I'm wondering about Governor Bryan, for example. If maybe you can tell me something about what you understood about him and motivated him as a white person to say, no, this is something that needs to be done.
Well, I have to tell you, in knowing Governor Bryan, he was kind of quiet in some areas, but he always was very observant. He might not give you like a personal thing, but I believe that he was really touched. And I believe in being in different environments, in different circles, and seeing and hearing different sides. I believe that the Martin Luther King, the whole thing, when you're seeing people just brutally beaten for no reason, the marches, the bus boycott, you bring that personally in some way, and there were people who made the changes. Then there were other people who said to me, I never knew. I never knew. So yes, yes. That's why we have to tell our story, but not just we as people of color, we as a nation can bring about the change. Okay. Thank you. At this time, we're going to, did I miss anybody? At this time, we're going to have Carlos to come back and to give us another song. Let's give her a hand.
This song is called The Battle Hymn of the Republic, and this is to commemorate Martin Luther King and the marches that he participated in to overcome all of the injustices that existed during that time. So this song, we're still marching on
yes.
the injustices that needs to be overcome. So I hope you enjoy this.
In the trunk. Would you go get them for me right quick? Be careful. Wasn't that wonderful?
Yes.
Now, the other thing that we want to do, just before we close out the program, is that there's a song that Dr. King sung more than any other.
I know what that song
is. Oh, do you know what that song is?
Yeah.
I thought it would be appropriate for us to sing that, and Carlos is going to lead us in that song.
If we could all just stand.
We're going to add Stan and... sing the song, and then you can have your seats, and we're going to finish out the program.
We shall overcome. We shall
present these lovely roses to Carlos. I appreciated her so very much for coming and singing for us. And she's still on the battlefield. Thank you, Carlos.
Thank you so much.
God bless you, dear. I think that it's important that we love one another. And you can do lots of things when you love a person. When they don't treat you right, you do right by them anyway. And there was a time in our homes where we were quick to say, do unto others. Do anybody ever remember that?
Yes.
Or am I the oldest in the house? Do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. I want to give a special thank you to the Nevada State Museum for inviting me. Bob, I'm going to say hello to you, and thank you. And Mary, Mary, stand up, Mary. This is Mary. I certainly thank you, and I just love the building. It's my first time being in the building, and I just want to say keep up the good works, and lots of people, they couldn't be here tonight because of other conflicts with their schedule. But I think that everyone should leave tonight resolving in yourself, saying I'm not going to be the same anymore. I'm going to stand up, speak up, and do something about it. And don't think that people's going to give you an open hand to love you. But you prepare yourself for rejection. Then you prepare yourself for a reward. Because Dr. King said, do the right thing. Always do the right thing. All right, Bob, is it in your hand now?
Well, I'm going to have Mary come
up. All right, Mary.
We're going to have Mary mention our program next month.
Oh, you already did. Tomorrow.
Which is natural history, but again, I want to thank Bertha for coming tonight.
Thank you. I just want to personally thank Bertha for everything that she did to make this happen tonight, and for everything she did for our communities, and also for this particular holiday, and everybody who was involved in that. And I think that we very often don't, like you said, don't realize all the different parts that have to come together to make something happen. But it's a good lesson. So I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.